my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Jesus, the way to the Father. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him, and I have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am the Father, and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Jesus promises the Holy Spirit. If you love me, you will obey what I command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus replied, If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him and will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. You heard me say, I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you loved me, you would be glad that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will
natural condition of men everywhere, at any time or place. I don't think people are in the least bit interested in eternal life these days. They don't even think about it. But what they do think is that if there is such a thing, then they will have earned that place by the good works, by the good life they've led. They think when they present their CV at the pearly gates, they will get in on their merits. Nothing could be further from the truth. It's never what I can do. It's all what Jesus does in me. And so you see, the whole thing depends on faith. And that's why it says in Galatians 5, verse 6, the only thing that matters, the only thing that matters is Manchester United, bacon and eggs for breakfast. The only thing that matters is working through love. Yeah, faith working through love. And faith is the gift of God. It's always and ever what God does in me. So, this is really what our vision means. Dying to self, that Christ may rise within us. So what is our place in all this? Well, we read in verse 15, if you love me, you will obey what I command. If obedience, you see, obedience is the currency of the Christian life. And that means obeying Jesus' worldview, taking on his worldview. Okay, it's all out of date, it's all proved wrong, it doesn't work today, too bad. That's what it's called to do. And also, taking on in obedience the Christian moral framework. Once again, terribly out of date, full of hate speech, inequality, and all the rest of it, too bad. As Christians, we are called to center on Jesus. And the thing about all these other philosophies of life and morals, compasses, is they're all man-centered. They come from man, they keep changing. But the thing about our worldview and moral compass is that it comes from God. The eternal God is behind it. Well, we don't want to be found calling God a liar, now do we? No. So in honor of Jesus, we take this on board, whether we like it or not. Now, and we seek to obey, that's our place. Now, not any old obedience will do, you see. Not any old obedience. And I want to contrast the obedience of Simon of Cyrene and my grandmother. Simon of Cyrene, you remember, was coming in from the country, and he was forced to carry the cross. We don't know anything about Simon of Cyrene, so I'm speculating this morning. Simon of Cyrene had saved up for ages for a trip to the city of Jerusalem, where he was going to do a very big shop, get lots of presents for the family, go to a show in the evening, stay at the Premier Inn and take a taxi home the next day, just enough money to do that. But instead of that, he was arrested by the Roman army and made to carry the cross. So you see, that was a terrible interruption in his life, and I should imagine his obedience, he would have to obey, otherwise the Roman soldiers would go and knock his house down. That's what they did in those days. So you can see, for Simon of Cyrene, who wasn't a disciple or anything, was doing his own thing, to have to do that, to obey, would have been a very sullen, resentful kind of obedience. We can be like that. We do these things because we have to, because we feel forced to, because of pressure. That's not the kind of obedience which Jesus wants. If you love me, obey. Our obedience doesn't come from the law, thou shalt. It comes out of love for Jesus. So my grandmother had a friend called Mrs. Gunn. And whenever Mrs. Gunn came to see my grandmother, she rolled out Sin has got to be paid for. God is not, is the most holy judge. And he is not going to say, oh well, you were a good chap, you tried hard, I don't mind. Sin has got to be paid for. And we're going to have to pay it to the very last farthing. Except we are found in Christ, who has paid the price for us. So we have freedom from sin. The blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. This is why to be born again is a supreme blessing. Fantastic thing to be a Christian. Because we don't have to pay the price of sin. And everything that Jesus is and has belongs to us. And our study is that through obedience, all that he is and has may manifest itself through us. Listen to these promises. And I will do, I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do greater things than these because I am going to the Father. This is 14 verse 12. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask anything in my name and I will do it. That's a fantastic promise and it's not a throwaway line. This is repeated several times and in the epistles. So the possibilities are endless of what Christ can do in and through us. There are many examples in the Bible of this fantastic blessing. Moses, for example, I think I mentioned this the other Sunday. Moses constructed the tent of meeting exactly as God told him to, down to the last stitch, the last ring, the last piece of silver, and the shape and color of the cloth. Everything Moses did, obedience, you see, exactly as God commanded. And when he did so, the anointing, the presence of God, came down on the tent of meeting. And God dwelt there. And the people of Israel saw God, a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day. And all the surrounding nations knew that the people of Israel could see their God and that he did dwell in the midst of them, and they were very wary of that. How do you think that a million people could survive wandering around in the desert? Well, you can't. But because of the presence of God, they did. They drank water from the rock, and they ate manna, which fell every day, morning and evening, for 40 years in the desert. I don't think that any nation has had such an experience of the loving care of God as he led them through the desert. No wonder that Moses was so hot on disobedience when they went to whoring after other gods. Moses instituted very severe penalties because if that had continued and the anointing left, then the people of Israel, a whole lot, would have perished in the desert. And another example is King Solomon, who built the temple exactly as God said, to the exact specifications. And again, the same thing happened. When they dedicated it, down came the presence of God on the temple and dwelt amongst the people. Again, the people of Israel knew that God dwelt amongst them, and so did the nations around, who were very wary. And it worked out in fantastic ways in Solomon's time. They defeated all their enemies because God went out with the armies. God gave them rest from their enemies, and also prosperity absolutely filled Jerusalem. Silver was common as muck in those days in Jerusalem because the nation was so prosperous they cornered the market. Unfortunately, Solomon disobeyed. His heart was turned by foreign women. He had 300 wives and 1,000 concubines. Amazing, but anyway. When he began to introduce heathen religion into the nation, God was angry with him. And when he died, he took away 8 tribes and gave them to Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who was an adventurer, leaving Solomon's son and heir, Rehoboam, with only 2 tribes. And then Pharaoh Necho came along, pinched all the silver and gold. shows faith in me will do what I have been doing and even greater things than these. This promise are still ours today in Christ. Now the church